Well, hello, Harvest Aurora. It's so good to be with you this morning. It's so good to worship God together as a church family. I am very thankful to be here. I've gotten to lead here in this building only once, and then, I don't know, like four or five times when we were in the other location. And I like what we got going on here. This room is pretty great. It's a great space to be able to worship God. And as Pastor Craig said, my name is Eddie Hoagland. I've had the privilege of serving here on staff for the past 9 years now, and I've served in various roles, but now I'm the lead pastor of worship and production, and I understand that today my job's different because it's not my job to lead you in a song, but I have the same job that Paul gave Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2, where he said, preach the word. Preach the word. To preach means to herald, and herald what? The message of the king. That's my job, to herald the message of the king, and the message of the king is God's word. And I hope you have a copy of God's word in your hands, because this is what we're after today. And if you don't have a copy, there's a copy of God's word in the seat in front of you. Would love for everyone to have it, because we want to hear from God today, and the only way we're going to hear from God for sure is because we're going to dive into his word. And I'm not like a speech writer for the king. I'm a herald of the king because the speech has already been written. My job is to just give to you what God has already said. Why? Because Psalm 19 says this. It says, the law of the Lord is perfect. You get that, right? Like, there's nothing I can do to make this better. It's absolutely perfect in every single way. The law of the Lord is perfect. And then it says this in Psalm 19. It says, reviving the soul. And I don't know about you, but I want that today. I would love for my soul to revive. I desire that sense of newness in my heart. And God can do it, and he can do it through his word. So today I want to talk about worship. No surprise there, I'm sure. But what it means to worship is to ascribe worth to God. That's what it means to worship God, to ascribe worth to him. So everything that we do when we gather, we do for God. When we sing, when the people on stage play these instruments, you know they're not playing for you. They're ultimately, first and foremost, they're playing for God. It's ascribing worth to God, and to help us to sing to God, it's all about God. And then we give of our tithes of offerings as an ascription to God, because we're saying, God, you're worthy of the trust that it takes to give of my tithes and offerings. And then we get to God's word, and we're ascribing worth to him, because we're saying we all sit under the authority of God's word together. And that's ascribing worth to him, saying everything he said is true. Every promise he has made will come to be. And that is what we're doing when we gather. We're worshiping God. And I just got to tell you, God's had to grow me as a worshiper this year. I've had to grow. I've had to live out some of the things I've sung to God for years. I've now had to live that. And it's interesting when God leads you to sing something first, and then you have to like actually do it. And God will make sure, it reminds me when the psalmist always said, like, I will perform my vows to the Lord. See, when you tell God something that you're going to sing something to him, that's a vow, and you're saying, I will live that out, God, when the time comes. And so whatever you're singing about being in the valley, just be knowledgeable about the fact that God might lead you to a valley. He might lead you to the opportunity to praise him in the valley. And I can say that 2019 has been that for me. And it's just been hard. If we could rewind back to January of this year, so that's like 8 months ago, and if you would have said, hey, Eddie, here's what the next 8 months are going to look like. Here's what's going to happen. I would have been like, yeah, I'm going to take a pass on that one. No, thank you. That doesn't sound very good to me, but it's just been hard, and not only with what's going on here at our church this year, but I got to say, like, things in my family have happened. Things have happened to my friends that are just like, it's just such a different and difficult year. And maybe 2019 isn't that year for you, but I know you've been through a year like that where you're like, man, that year, what happened that year? But even though it's been hard, it's been in these times of worship when we gather every single weekend that I have just found joy in worshiping God, because this is where I can rest. You understand that? In other places, you feel the pressure of like, I got to give this result. I got to perform in this way. All these things, these pressures I have in my life. But then I get to worshiping God, and I'm just like, I can rest here. I can be here. God already knows who I am. God knows me more than anyone else. And I get a rest out of that. I get a safety out of that in our times of worship. And as we've been going through these past few months, in one of the most difficult days for me, I sat down in my living room, and I was sitting there with my wife. And I said, babe, I don't think I can do this anymore. I just don't got it. I don't have it in me anymore. Like, this is just too hard. It's too crazy. I don't know what's going on. I don't understand everything. It's just like hitting that wall. And praise God for a godly wife who looked at me and said, "You're right. You're not strong enough. But God is. And God can carry you through this." And instead of spending all your time thinking about, you know, how difficult things are, think of that as the opportunity to press into God, press into the one who is the answer, who holds the answer in his hand, and put all my effort there. And I stand here today to just tell you guys, I want to give testimony of the fact that God has met me there. And though even like when I wake up in the morning, I feel the weight of like, I don't know what I'm headed into today, but I give testimony that God has given me everything I need for that day. His grace has been sufficient. And when I walk into a meeting, I'm like, I don't want to walk into this meeting today. And God's like, I will give you the strength. I will give you what you need to be able to do what I called you to do. And then when I get a phone call, and I'm like, oh, I don't want to take this phone call right now. And God says, I put you at the place, I put you in a seat, and I want you to do what I called you to do, and I will give you the strength. And I just want to let you know, God does that. God is our strength. He gives strength to the weary. And start thinking about the fact that you're weary as an opportunity for God to give you that strength and to give you that power. And it's been in these times of worship that I've felt recharged, I've felt rested, I've felt poured into by God. And so we're going to dive into God's word together to see what we can learn about worship today. But before we do that, let me just pray for us. Father, we thank you that you meet us here. We thank you that we can sense that you are glorified and exalted in this place because you are the one that we worship. We do not lift high the name of anyone in this place. We do not lift high the name of a church. We lift high the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. He is the one that we worship. And so, Father, I just ask that you would help me be true to this passage, that I would be close to the things that you have said, because that's how I know we're going to hear from you, and you will be glorified through it. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. All God's people said, amen. Amen. All right, we're going to go to 2 Samuel chapter 24, if you want to turn there. Second book of Samuel chapter 24. We're going to be studying verses 18 to the end of the chapter, which is the end of the book. But before we even go there to 2 Samuel chapter 24, I just want to give you a little context of like, why are we headed there? Well, it's because of what Romans 12:1 says. This is where our message is coming from. And I have this verse on the screen. You can see it there. It says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, he's appealing to the church. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. So here we have a picture that Paul is giving to us, but it's very different than what would have been the norm. When you're talking about an altar or a sacrifice, you think of that animal that's being placed on the altar and then the fire consumes it. That animal's not alive, you know? It's in its dying that it's sacrificial, and yet Paul here throws in something completely new. He said, it's not in the dying that I want you to be sacrificial, it's in your living that I want you to be sacrificial. Why? Because it's your spiritual worship. It's your spiritual worship to do that. And notice what the passage says. Be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. To be holy means to be set apart. And if you are a child of God, you need to understand you're set apart. You're not like the rest. Why? Because of what God has done. Because if you've turned away from your sin and embraced Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are now set apart by God and you are holy, you are pure. Why? Because when God looks at you, he now sees the righteousness of his Son, Jesus Christ, when he looks at you, and that's what sets you apart. Not only that, it says holy and acceptable to God. And an amazing, simple, but profound truth is that God receives the things he requests. So what makes us acceptable to God is that God is making us into what he has requested us to be. And what he wants you to be is a living sacrifice so that that can be your spiritual worship. Spiritual, meaning not physical. So we're not talking about building an altar, being a sacrifice in the physical sense. We're talking about something spiritual. And that's what I want to talk to you about today, building an altar of worship. I want to talk to you today about building an altar of worship. Now, I'm not an altar building pro myself, so we got to go to someone who does know how to build an altar and thankfully we have God's word to be able to teach us. And so that's why we're going to 2 Samuel chapter 24, because this is where David's going to build an altar. Let me give you the context real quick before we dive into verse 18, because you need to understand what's happening in this passage. At the beginning of the chapter, David sins against the Lord by sending Joab, one of his officers, to complete a census, to count the warriors of Israel. And at first glance, when I was studying this, I was like, why is that like a big deal? It ends up being sin against the Lord, that David sins against God by doing that. And, well, a couple things. One, we know it's sin because David realizes it's sin. So it's obviously sin because David acknowledges that. But then also a couple thoughts. One would be God not only cares about what you do, God cares about how you do it as well. It's not just what you're doing, it's the manner in which you do it. And when you study the parallel passage in 1 Chronicles chapter 21, we find out they didn't even do the census the right way. They leave out two of the tribes of Levi and Benjamin, and they leave them out, and so it's not even a correctly done census. But more than that, I think it's an expression of what was in David's heart, which was that he was starting to rely upon what he could see with these eyes instead of with these eyes. He was relying on his own strength. It was a declaration of just trusting in his earthly power. Because, I mean, he was receiving orders from the Lord, and if God was going to call him to war, I think God knows how many warriors he has to be able to pull it off. Because if you're receiving, as an Israelite king, you're receiving orders from God, and David's actually acting a lot more like what a Near Eastern king would have been acting like in those days, right? Counting his armies and just sensing his power. And then in the chapter, David realizes he sinned greatly against the Lord, but this time it's without a prophet. Because this is David, you know the guy, David the shepherd in the field, writing songs, playing his little harp, David and Goliath, and then David now king. David sins with Bathsheba, and then the Lord sends the prophet Nathan to rebuke David and to call him towards repentance. But here we are later on in David's life, and notice, he sins, but the scripture says that his heart strikes him this time. What an awesome thing to see David growing as a follower of the Lord, because this time it's without a prophet, because David wasn't a great king because of all his choices, okay? David was a great king because he was a repentant king. See, Saul, the king before him, he confessed when he got caught, but David is the one who repents, and his heart strikes him that he had sinned greatly against the Lord. And so the Lord tells David that he's going to give him three options for judgment. He's going to get either 3 years of famine, 3 months of being chased by his enemies, or 3 days of pestilence. And I cannot imagine what that would be like. Lord, please never give me the option of choosing my judgment. And it says that his heart is greatly distressed. Yeah, no joke. That's a terrible choice. And yet something beautiful happens. David says, I'm going to put myself in your hands, God. Basically, like, you can pick it. Why? Because he says that he's seen God to be merciful, but he had seen that man was not merciful. And so what I think is happening there is he's saying, not the 3 months of being chased by my enemies, by man, because man isn't merciful. Anything you want, God, I'm rather take that because you are merciful. And so what ends up happening is 3 days of pestilence. So the angel of the Lord is executing this judgment. And as soon as he begins executing this judgment, 70,000 men die just like that. 70,000 men, total number, we don't know. For sure over 100,000, I would guess. And they just die like that. And then the angel of the Lord comes up to Jerusalem now, and he's about to execute this judgment, and then there's a pause. And that's where we're jumping in. That's verse 18. You need to understand the tension of what's happening. Like, death is at the door. The judgment is coming. And here we are in verse 18, and we're going to see how David builds an altar. And we're going to study what are the principles we can pull from as we build our altar of worship to God. So verse 18 says, "And Gad came that day to David and said to him, 'Go up, raise an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusite.' So David went up at Gad's word, as the Lord commanded," because Gad is David's seer, so this is how the Lord is communicating with David. Verse 20, "And when Araunah looked down, he saw the king and his servants coming on toward him. And Araunah went out and paid homage to the king with his face to the ground. And Araunah said, 'Why has my lord the king come to his servant?' David said, 'To buy the threshing floor from you in order to build an altar to the Lord, that the plague may be averted from the people.'" That the plague may be averted from the people. So David, what he's doing, this is where it all starts. He's seeking God's mercy. And as we build our altar of worship, that's where it starts for us too. We seek the mercy of God. Point one is we seek the mercy of God. And mercy is when God withholds the thing that you deserve. That is what God's mercy is. And so here we see it because he's saying that the plague may be averted. That's what they deserve because their king, David, had sinned greatly against the Lord. And what they're seeking is the mercy of God, that God would withhold the things that we deserve. And that is what we need too. You need to understand that even though it's, you know, thousands of years later, here we are, and we need God's mercy just as much as anyone ever has. And it's important to start here as we build our altar of worship, because then it starts to make sense that as our awareness of our need for God's mercy grows, then our thankfulness grows as well. And it starts to make sense that we enter his gates with thanksgiving. Why? Because every breath I take is God withholding the thing I deserve. What we deserve is death. What we deserve is condemnation. What we deserve is shame. And God says, you don't have to have that. I'll put that on my son so that you can have my mercy. And God is giving mercy to us today. And as we gather in worship and we get to sing these songs, we only get to do that because God is being merciful to us. And as you think of that and as you focus on that, your thankfulness should be growing as well. And because your greater your awareness of your need for mercy, the greater your thankfulness to God will be. So then continuing the passage, it starts with seeking the mercy of God. Then verse 22, it says, then Araunah said to David, let my lord the king take and offer up what seems good to him. Here are the oxen for the burnt offering and the threshing sledges and the yokes of the oxen for the wood. All this, O king, Araunah gives to the king. That's really interesting. He's saying he's giving it to him, whereas just in the verses before, we see that David came to buy it from him. I don't know exactly why Araunah did what he did, but all I know is if I was in his shoes, and I'm like, here comes the angel of the Lord he's already killed 70,000 men. Now here we are. It's like, let's build an altar. Yeah, let's get this process going as fast as we can. Like, you can just have it. Like, whatever it is to speed it up. And yet, David's going to say no. What? Why would he say no to that? What a great offer, right? All this, O King Araunah gives to you. And that's in verse 23. All this, O King Araunah gives to the king. And Araunah said to the king, may the Lord your God accept you. Interesting parallel between what we've been talking about in Romans 12, that we are acceptable to God. May the Lord your God accept you. And then why does David say no? Well, it's right here in the passage. Look at verse 24. But the king said to Araunah, no, but I will buy it from you for a price. I will not offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God that cost me nothing. So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. I will not offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God that cost me nothing. I'm not going to do it, David says. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to take the offer that you give me, Araunah, which was free and convenient. Not going to do it. Why? Because this is for God. I'm not going to give God something that's like just that easy. It needs to cost me something because it's sacrificial. Because I want to be a living sacrifice to God. And that's why I'm okay that it cost me something. That's the second point. We seek the mercy of God, and then you give of yourself sacrificially. You are to give of yourself sacrificially. You know, the heart of a worshiper is not a heart of minimalism. So what I mean by that is you don't get to come to God and say, God, what's like the bare minimum I need to do to worship you? Like, where's the threshold of like, now you count as a worshiper? That's not the heart of a worshiper. The heart of a worshiper is the exact opposite. It's, God, what more can I give to you? How can there be more of you and less of me? That's the heart of a worshiper, and worship calls you beyond the threshold of your personal preference. So here's what I mean by that. Imagine a circle around you, and everything within your reach would be your preference. So here are the things I like. Here are the things I don't like. Here's the things I prefer. Here are the things I don't prefer. Anything within your reach would be your personal preference. And what worship does is it calls you outside that circle and into new territory where you're not consumed with thinking about what do I want, what do I not want. And worship calls you into new territory where you start thinking, what does God want? What does God want of me? And I'm not thinking about, do I like this or not? Stop thinking about that. And you say, what does God want? He's the one I'm worshiping. And so it's going to call you beyond that point of your personal preference. That's what worship does. And, you know, why do you think the temperature in our worship services is going up these past few months. And I've been talking with people in small groups and campuses as I've been traveling, and like one of the things that consistently, and what actually drove the decision of starting the worship nights that we started this past week, was there's something happening. And I don't pretend to understand it all. All I know is the Lord's doing something in regards to worship here at our church. And could I just suggest to you, maybe what's happening is the temperature's going up in our worship services because it's costing us a little bit more. Maybe our passion is increasing because our desperation is increasing. Maybe it's costing you a little bit more this year than it was last year. I know that's true for me. I can just tell you, like, if I would have came and led a service a year ago to sing the songs we've sung today, it just would have been easier overall to lead those songs. And today, it's a little bit harder to lead those songs, but everything we're singing is still true. And it was just as true back then, but what's different is that it's costing me more now. And I'm just here to tell you, that's okay. I think that's a good thing. Why? Because we don't want to give anything to the Lord that costs us nothing. We want it to cost us something because we want to give of ourselves sacrificially. So then how does that show up in our services? How could we give sacrificially as we worship God every single weekend? Well, one way would be to show up early enough to be actually in the room when it's time to worship Jesus Christ. And look, I get it. That is not an easy task sometimes. We have two kids, they're 6 and 4, and I love them to death. But sometimes when we go serve, I normally lead worship at the Crystal Lake campus, and so we have to get up at like 5:30 in the morning. If my wife's serving with me, we get the kids up, and you go into the room at 5:30 in the morning with a 6 and 4-year-old, and you don't know what you're going to get, all right? So it's like, well, we'll see how today goes. And then we get them up, we get them ready, we go to church, and I mean, we serve, they're in harvest kits for both services, and it's a lot. But I think it's okay. Why? Because if I'm going to sacrifice anything, it should be for Jesus Christ, and it should be for worshiping Him. And I get that it's not easy to actually be able to check in the kids and then be in the room when the service starts. That is hard. But what I'm saying to you is it's okay that it's hard, because you don't want to offer anything to God that costs you nothing. You don't want to offer things to God like Arana offered to David and said, this would have been convenient. Well, maybe it's not super convenient, but that's okay, because I want to give it to Jesus Christ. He's the reason I'm coming. I'm not coming for any person in the band. I'm not coming for any pastor. I am coming here to lift high the name of Jesus Christ, who is my Lord and who is my Savior, and that's why it's okay. That's why it's okay that it cost me something, so I want to show up early enough, and then I don't want to leave early either. Right? Because if I want everything that God has for us today, I don't want to leave early. And maybe you're that kind of person who today you got your lunch appointment scheduled for like 12:02 for some reason. Like, can I just suggest maybe let's try 12:30 just so that there's a little bit of space so you don't have to like bolt out of here as soon as the sermon's done or whatever's going on. Let's be here for everything that God has for us, not for a person. Again, I just reiterate, I'm telling you, the reason you should do that is because it's your worship to God, and it should cost you something, and it's okay that it's inconvenient, and it's okay that you got to sit in line to get out of the parking lot. All those things, it's okay because it's for God. And we don't want to give things to God that cost us nothing. So let me give you just 5 offerings of sacrificial worship. These are 5 practical things that are ways you can give sacrificially to God in worship as we're building our altar of worship. And there are many more, but these are just the 5 that I had on my heart to share with you. And the first is singing. Singing. God wants our singing. Psalm 96, verse 1 says, "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth." The word sing there is the word shir in Hebrew, which is pretty easy because it just means to sing, so no word study needed there. God wants us to sing, but notice what he says, sing to the Lord all the earth. So it seems to be that the only requisite for you to be the one that this verse applies to is, do you live on planet earth? And we all qualify, right? Hopefully you live on planet earth. I hope you live on planet earth. And that's what God is saying. He wants you, every one of you, to sing to him. And that is a beautiful thing. What an amazing thing that the God of the universe, who spoke and the world was formed, who knows you, he knows the hairs on your head, he keeps your tears in a bottle, the one who knows you, he wants you to sing to him. That is a beautiful thing. And see, here's what's going to happen today is you're going to want to make yourself the exception to the rule. Because, why? Because you're hitting that threshold of your personal preference, and you're going to start telling yourself, well, but if Eddie knew who I was, he would know that I'm not part of that verse. Like, God doesn't want my singing. It's not good. God says nothing of the quality of the singing. God just wants your singing. It doesn't matter to us as a worship team. We could care less how good or bad you sound. What we want is we want for you to do what God's asking you to do. And God wants you to sing. And maybe that is outside of the realm of like your preference. It reminds me when I was a worship leader, I started leading worship when I was 15 years old. And I'm a pastor's kid. I grew up in Mexico City, Mexico. My mom's Mexican. My dad's American. And I started leading worship when I was 15. And a 15-year-old is not super wise. Maybe that's the best way of saying it. A 15-year-old is a 15-year-old. And for that job, it was kind of like, hey, you kind of play guitar. You kind of sing. You got the job. Like, congratulations. There weren't many interviews in that day for the job. So I just get thrown up there, and I don't have a pastor even training me. Like, this is what you're supposed to do. Here's what God's word says on worship. I had none of that. So I'm just like trial by fire, learning how to be a worship leader at the age of 15. And one of the things that wasn't super wise that I did, I was like leading worship, and I look out there, and I see one of my friends, and I'm like, oh, he's not singing. Well, I got to do something about that. And so I'm going to go talk to him after the service. And the reason that's not wise is because you guys need to know, I'm not telling the worship team, like, study the people in the congregation and, like, decide what they're doing. No, no. What we want to do is we just want to lead you by example. We want to show you what it is that God wants and then invite you to do the things that God wants. That's what we want to be as a worship ministry. But as a 15-year-old, I wasn't super wise and understand that. So I go to my friend, and he was my friend, so I guess there's a little bit of leeway there. And I go up to him and I say, hey, I noticed you're not singing. Why aren't you singing? And he's kind of taken back. He's like, wow, that's pretty direct. And he was just like, ultimately, it's just not me. That was his answer. Like, it's not who I am. I just don't like singing. And I was like, okay. So then I just left it at that. And then a few months later, it got interesting because then we go to a concert together. And it's his favorite band. And I look over and he's singing. I'm like, okay. So you sing here. And then we go to his nephew's birthday party. After that, and he's singing happy birthday to his nephew. I was like, so you're singing here. And so here's the thing. Look, I get it. And some of you, singing's not your thing. But the point I'm trying to make is God knows that singing's not your thing, and yet he still wants you to sing. And it could be true that you literally don't have to sing anywhere else. But may it be true that if there's only one place you sing, it's for God himself and in worship to him. And that you would give him the things he's requested. He wants you to sing. He wants you to sing. Not only that, but then God also wants you to shout. That's the second thing we're going to look into. God wants you to shout. Psalm 66 verse 1 says, shout for joy to God, all the earth. Oh, well, there it is again. Who does this apply to? All the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. That's the word ruah. In the Hebrew, the word shout is ruah, which, side note, because I'm from Mexico, I speak Spanish, and anytime I have to say a word in Hebrew, I say it with my Spanish accent, and people think I know what I'm talking about. It's a good trick. So there's the word ruah, and it means to cry out greatly, to split the ears with sound, to raise the war cry, to cheer, to shout in triumph. And this is what God wants, shout for joy, to shout in triumph. And look, I get it. We all grew up in different families. So if you were to come to the Hoagland household for dinner, you would have been like, you guys aren't talking. You're just shouting at each other the whole time, like this and that. And you see the youngest sibling being like, oh, can I say something? And it's just like, it's such a shouting match in that family. And I've been to other families where you get there like, we're so glad to see you. It's so good that you're here. And then you sit at the dinner table, and I can hear the sizzle of the food louder than I can hear the prayer that's being whispered somewhere else in the room. You know, they're just so soft-spoken and reserved. And look, there's nothing wrong with being that kind of family. But what I'm coming to tell you today is no matter where you grew up, no matter what your preference is, God wants you to shout. And not just shout, not just like, oh, I'm just going to scream. No, what does he say? He says, shout for joy to God, shout in triumph. Do you understand that if you have Jesus, you win? That no matter what you've lost in your life, no matter what's ahead of you, if you have Jesus, you have a reason to shout. You have a reason to sing. Oh, now we're getting warmed up. Amen. 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 And this is what God wants. He wants you to shout for joy. He wants you to sing. And not only that, but he wants us to clap. Psalm 47 verse 1 says, clap your hands, all peoples. Do you hear the voice of God speaking to us today? Who? Clap your hands, all peoples. shout to God with loud songs of joy. In the Hebrew, the word for clap is the word taka, which just means to strike the hands together. It comes from in the root of the word, we find out that it's like a trumpet blast, but with our hands. So a trumpet can go boom, you know, it can blast. In the same way with our hands, we're going boom. It's a blast by striking our hands together, and that's what clapping is. And God says, I want taka. Taka, all peoples, shout to God with loud songs of joy. And so back to the 15-year-old worship leader in Mexico City, and I'm leading worship, and I have the youth choir behind me. And just to give you a little context of our church, my dad's a pastor there, and he never preached anything like don't clap or, I mean, nothing of the sort was ever said from the stage. No leader had ever said that. But if you came to our church, you would stand there and you'd be like, yeah, we definitely don't clap in this church. You know, like, you just knew. Like, this is not a clapping church. And so I'm up there, and I'm leading with the youth choir, and we're leading this song in the early 2000s. It was, we want to see Jesus lifted high, a banner that, anybody remember that song? It was, yeah, so maybe some of you do, some of you don't. If you do, help me out here with the chorus. This is where we find out if you know the song, because in the chorus you're supposed to do, we want to see. Hey, a lot's changed since the early 2000s. We're not as coordinated with our clapping these days, but you're supposed to clap three times in the chorus. And so we had never clapped in church. I got the youth choir behind me, and I'm singing the verse. I'm like, queremos a Cristo proclamar. And I just start sweating bullets, because I know the chorus is coming, and I'm like, here it comes. We're going to clap for the first time in our church. Like, it's coming, and I'm just, I start sweating. Why? Because I'm absolutely consumed with what are the people going to think? What are the people going to do? What are the people? And that's all I could think about, and I was so nervous. That's why I'm sweating, side note, nothing really happened. We just got to the chorus. The choir clapped. Everyone just stared at us, and it was over. Like, that was it. But the problem was I was doing something, and again, I was a young worship leader, just trial by fire, and I was doing something without teaching why we do it, okay? That's not good leadership. You should actually say the reason why we're doing it, and the better way of doing it is what I'm doing right now and showing you that we clap because God wants us to clap. And if you don't teach people that, then they're just going to make an assumption, and there's two assumptions that people make. They think it's either a fad, right? Like, it's just going to come and go, like skinny jeans, they came, they went, you know, like whatever it is, they think it's just going to come. Clapping's like that, it's a fad. Or, you know, maybe it's not a fad, or I think this one's even worse. Then you start thinking it's generational. And it's like, oh, hey, we're going to, you know, clapping in our church is like, let the young people clap. Like, that's more of a young thing to clap. And that is not what God's word says. God says, clap your hands, all peoples, no matter where you grew up, no matter the color of your skin, no matter how much money's in your bank account, it does not matter. God wants you to clap. And I've seen time and time again, what God blesses is people doing the things he's asked us to do. God doesn't bless a style of music more than another. God doesn't bless some band or some brand more than another. What God blesses is when someone is led to do the things he's asked. And God will keep doing that. Why? Because he's blessing his word. And if God took the time to tell us he wants us to sing, he wants us to shout, he wants us to clap, we should want to give that to him. And if it costs you something, that's okay. Because you should not want to give anything to the Lord that costs you nothing. God wants you to sing. God wants you to shout. God wants you to clap. And then this, God wants dancing. Woo, now it got controversial in the room. Now we're not so comfortable, right? Well, here's the thing. I have to be true to God's word. And so I have to teach you what God's word says. And God actually talks about this. Psalm 149, verse 3 says, let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with the tambourine and lyre. Now, don't be fooled by the tense in the ESV where it says, let them praise his name with dancing. That's not like, you know, if there's a person, it could be optional for that person, like, let them do it somewhere over there. That's not what this verse is saying. A better way of saying it is, let it be so, or may it be so that his name is praised with dancing. The word dancing there is the word machol, which means to twist or whirl, to dance, including physical movements of various sorts, a joyful trembling in worship. This is what God is calling for, a joyful trembling in worship. And notice it says, dancing, including physical movements of various sorts. So it's not like, you know, it's not like there's a version of the Macarena that God's like, that's worship. You know, like, it's not like prescribed movement. It's a general term on purpose. I think what he's getting at here is just movement inside of worship, that it wouldn't be a static thing, that there could be movement inside of worshiping God. Sometimes when you're studying a Hebrew word, one of the most useful tools is to go back to the root of the word and to see what other words are connected to this, because you can get a better understanding of, well, God, what is God exactly saying with that word? And the root of this word actually has a negative application, which means writhing as with pain. It's the opposite. It's writhing, but as with pain. And I find that to be super helpful. And the root's also connected to the word that refers to birthing pains, like labor pains. And I'll never know what that's like. And so I have to come up with what for Eddie is writhing as with pain. And for me, that's stubbing my toe. That's writhing as with pain, because that is not a fun thing. So I remember back when we moved here 9 years ago, we moved here without a bed. And so we go to Schaumburg, we go to IKEA, and we get this bed. IKEA's pretty great. You get I was thinking it's like a queen bed. It's the one we still have today. We get this queen bed. I think it was like $300 or so dollars, but they don't tell you that, yeah, it's $300, but then you got to go home and you got to spend 8 hours building your bed. And then you got to spend an hour going back in the steps to catch up to the step that you messed up an hour ago. Then you finally get to finish your bed. And, I prefer words. I'm not super great at following just Swedish pictures of, like, how to build a bed. But it's just, that's my style. But then you finish and you're like, oh, wow, this is a great bed. It's super modern. I love how it looks. But the downside is it's kind of a trap, because the way they're built, the comforter spills over the bed. And so you don't know where the bed is. And, guys, that's just a trap. What they want is they want you to hurt yourself. That's what they want. And so there's this trap, and then you walk by the bed, and I'm like, well, I'm pretty sure I'm supposed to sleep somewhere in there. And so I start walking towards the bed, and then I stub my toe right on the corner. And I've seen different people respond different ways to that experience. Some people, they stub their toe, and they just start running in circles. Like, they just start running. Somehow that's, like, helpful to them. I'm a little bit more introverted. For me, it's like I stub my toe, and I'm like, and I'm like, enter into the fetal position. I mean, it's just like so much pain. Because it's not like, oh man, my toe is hurting. No, it's Eddie is hurting. Like, everything about me is in pain, because the pain is so great that I can't stay still. The pain is so great that I can't stay still. And could it be that as you give testimony to yourself of the goodness of God, that the joy of the Lord would get to be so great in your heart, you're just like, I just can't stay still. I can't do the, like, static, stoic, like, I can't do that. Why? Because the joy of the Lord is just too awesome. Like, what I'm thinking about, that he has been good and he's revealed his plan to me, and he said it's to prosper me, and I think of how faithful he's been when I've been found to be foul. To be faithless, God is still faithful. All the things that I fill my mind with, the joy gets to be so great that I just can't stay still. And so there's some sort of motion in my worship, and I think that's what it is. That's Machul, God saying, let it be so that my name is praised with that. That the reason I'm moving in worship is because of God, and it's in response to what God has done. And if God wants that, I want to give that to him. And the last thing is the raising of hands. We find it in Psalm 143, verse 6. I stretch out my hands to you. My soul thirsts for you like a parched land. Selah. I stretch out my hands to you. That's the word paros, which means to spread out or stretch over. And notice in the context, it's pretty clear. It's as my soul thirsts for you like in a parched land. And it's an expression of need to say, God, I need you. And maybe that's you today. Maybe you're in the parched land. Maybe you're in that dry place. And your expression to God today could be to just stretch your hands out to him and say, God, I need you. I'm thirsting for you. And it doesn't only mean that. Another psalm says, lift up your hands to the holy places and bless the Lord. And so it can also just mean an expression of praise, an expression of, God, you are awesome. And it can be need, but it can also be praise. And this is one of the things that God wants. And as you can imagine, if I grew up in a church that didn't have much clapping, we didn't have raising of hands either. And side note, God's done awesome things in my home church in Mexico City. If we went there, you'd be like, what's this church? Is that the church he was talking about? No, because God's been teaching them from his word just as much as he's been teaching me. And but back then, I had never raised my hands. And I went to Liberty University when I was 18 years old. I moved from Mexico to Liberty University to get my worship degree because the Lord had called me to worship ministry. And there I was, and as I started looking into the scriptures, I'm like, well, here it is. Like, God wants this. It was news to me. I know it sounds a little crazy, but I grew up, I mean, I was a pastor's kid, and it was news to me that God wanted this. I just always thought of it as like optional. God's okay with this. But as I dive into God's word, God's not just okay with it. God wants it. And those are two very different things. And so then I get to college and I'm being trained as a worship leader. And I just decide like, I'm just going to go for it. I'm just going to raise my hands today. And so I go to class and they would lead us in worship. At the beginning of class, they'd lead us in a few songs. And so that day that I decided I was going to raise my hands, I get there and I sit in the back row. You better believe I sat in the back row. And so I get there and they start leading us in worship. And in my mind, it's just covered with all these ideas like, wait, how am I supposed to do? Is it this, down, you know, like up, sideways? I don't know. When's the right moment? Is it the chorus? Like, does it have to do with the song? I just start filling my mind with all these things. And I just sense the Lord being like, stop. Like, you're really overthinking it, Eddie. Like, just raise your hands. Like, it's not that crazy. And so there I was, and it was very uncomfortable for me, but I knew I wanted to do it because the Lord was asking this of me, and so they're leading us in worship, and so I'm just like, okay, and they're up, you know, like, that was it. There wasn't anything crazy about the moment, and it was awkward, just like I'm trying to play it back to you. It was awkward for me, because I think this is a really important thing that you need to know, that worship calls you beyond the threshold of your personal preference, and it's not necessarily going to feel like a great moment. And in that day, when I raised my hands for the first time to the Lord, I didn't sense anything special in regards to my experience, but I sensed something super special in regards to my obedience of the Lord that day. And now, I mean, now I can never worship God without my hands going up in the air at some point. It's just so natural to me. But what I want you to hear is that it wasn't natural to me at first. And many, many of these things are not going to be natural to you, but that's where I want you to stop thinking about those things and start thinking, does God want this of me? And I'm showing you in God's word that God does want this from you. He wants these things from all of us. And then the passage finishes. Verse 25, we seek the mercy of God, then we give of ourselves sacrificially, and then this. Verse 25 says, and David built there an altar to the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. So the Lord responded to the plea of the land, and the plague was averted from Israel. We seek the mercy of God, we give of ourselves sacrificially, and then this. We see the response of the Lord. We see the response of the Lord. And what a blessing that is. Now notice, I didn't say we get to decide the response of the Lord. God is the only one who decides the outcome. And I'm not telling you today that if you want to be growing as a worshiper and building an altar of worship, that you're supposed to seek the mercy of God, give of yourself sacrificially, and then you get to decide what God's going to do. That's not how it works. God is the one who can only be trusted with the outcome, and that's exactly where it should stay. He's the only one who's the sovereign Lord of all, and I want to keep that in his hands. But here's the amazing thing. We get to see the response of the Lord. And what happened here in this passage is a plague was averted. And here's the answer of God as they sought his mercy, as they gave of themselves sacrificially. God answers and the plague is averted. And if you are a child of God, you need to know that today a plague has been averted for you as well. That a plague has been averted for you as well. What you had coming your way has been averted because of the work of Jesus Christ. And sometimes when we're studying the Old Testament, it can feel a little distant. And I get that. There's certain things like observing specific Levitical ceremonial law that we don't observe today. But there's a lot we have in common. There's a lot that we need to study so that we can understand the significance of what has happened and what we stand in today. Because you need to know that today, as we gather to worship Jesus Christ, we worshiped him with a priest. That happened today. We worship God with a priest, and not just any priest, but with a high priest. And not just any high priest, but with the great high priest. For Hebrews chapter 4 says, Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Today we worship God with a great high priest. And we worship God because a sacrifice was made so that we could be in relationship with him. A sacrifice was offered to God so that we could worship him. It reminds me when John the Baptist sees Jesus coming, what does he say? He says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." He is the Lamb of God. He's the sacrifice. A sacrifice had to be made so that we could be in relationship with God. And here we see David building an altar and offering up a sacrifice. And all that was temporary. And it was all pointing to the ultimate sacrifice, which would be Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. And you know, when I first studied this passage, it didn't click exactly the significance of the location. Until later in my study, and man, the weight of what I was studying just increased that much more, because I didn't realize, like, this is the buying of the threshing floor where David goes to Arana to build this altar to avoid the plague. But hundreds of years before, Abraham took Isaac up to be offered, and it was on this very same piece of land. And as he takes Isaac up, what does God do? God provides a substitution. And then years later, we get to the threshing floor and David builds an altar and the plague is averted. And then David gathers up the materials and he gives it to his son Solomon to build what? The temple. And where does he build it? Right there. And the threshing floor becomes the temple mount and the temple is built and the glory of God dwells there. And then years later, through the gates of that city would come the Messiah, and he would minister, and he would preach and teach, and he wouldn't abolish the law, but he would fulfill the law. And then they take him outside the city, and he would be the Lamb of God slain for us. All that, you see God's plan for us, and you see it in this moment right here, and what he's teaching us about building an altar, because he's going to get to Romans 12, where God wants us to know, and he appeals to us. He says, "I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, and I appeal to you, Harvest Bible Chapel, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship." So the question is this: how can you grow as a worshiper? Because I know how this goes. I know how this goes. As I was preaching and as I start listing things that people do and don't do, there's a voice in your head and it's saying, you know what? You're too far gone, like in the category of worship. Like, you're just so far from where you need to be and you should just give up, and it's trying to overwhelm you. And I'm telling you today, do not listen to that voice. For there was another voice that was telling you, hey, maybe in this one thing, you could just start growing. Maybe in this one thing you could take the next step in. I want you to listen to that voice, because the voice of God doesn't seek to condemn you, because we know that there is now, therefore, no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So it's not to condemn you. God wants to grow you. God is your father. He loves you. He wants you to grow. What father would look upon a child who's trying to walk, and then as the child begins to walk, it trips and falls, and the father would be like, "What's wrong with you?" No father would ever do that to his child. Why? Because the father's glad that the child is growing and that the child is starting to walk. And you need to hear from God today. What he wants for you is he just wants you to grow. He just wants you to take another step and pick one thing. I don't want to overwhelm you. Just pick one thing that's on your heart and say, "Yeah, God, I've never done that. Would you give me the chance to grow in that?" And don't, if there's nothing else but just one thing, that's totally fine. Just pick that one thing. Let's bow our heads right now and close our eyes. And I just want to give you the chance to tell that to God. Say, God, I'd like to grow as a worshiper in this one area. Just tell him that. And whatever he puts on your heart to grow in, say yes to the Lord. And ask him to give you the opportunity to grow in that. Father, you are the one that we worship, and we thank you for how you speak to us through your word. Who are we that you're even mindful of us? Who are we that you would ever give a second of the day to think about us? And yet you do. And you tell us that you love us, and you love us like no one ever could. And we love you only because you loved us first, with that perfect love, with that unconditional love. And so how could we not give you the things you ask of us? How could we not do that? How could we elevate our preference above yours? You're the one who saved us. You're the one who died on that cross. And so we want to respond to you, Lord, and we thank you for the opportunity to grow. For everything we know we need to grow in is a sign of your grace, because the first step towards change is going to be us being able to see it. So we give you praise here today, God, for the eyes that are open towards that, knowing that you are a loving Father who wants us to grow. And we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, let's stand together and let's respond to the Lord.